I had a long discussion with the president about this this evening. He supports our actions 100%. We talked about the fact that we've got to find, everybody believes we need to get to the answers and resolve this situation, the concern everybody has about what exactly happened in the Freddie Gray incident. That's one whole situation. This is an entirely different situation. This is lawless gangs of thugs roaming the streets, causing damage to property and injuring innocent people, and we're not going to tolerate that.
Hardest thing for you to see, whether it be online or on TV today, some visual thing that you saw in the city of Baltimore that just really got to your core?
Well, I mean, all of it was disturbing. It's hard to say any one thing, but when you see when the law enforcement officers were hurt and injured, when police cars were on fire, when buildings were being set ablaze, it was very disturbing. And you know, we called everybody together in advance of the city requesting, so we were fully ready to engage immediately.
It sounds like you're planning for this to go over multiple days. Are you worried that you're not going to get this under control tonight?
Well, we have no way of predicting. I can tell you this. We're going to put every available asset and as much manpower as it possibly takes to get this under control as quickly as we possibly can. And we're going to maintain the state of emergency until it's put to rest.
Can you tell us what the president had to say in the conversation?
He thanked me for the action, said he thought we were doing the right thing. He said, I assume that you and your team will be exercising due restraint. I assured him that we were. The last thing we want to do is escalate the violence. But I also assured him that we weren't going to stand by and allow our city of Baltimore to be taken over by thugs. And he said that the Justice Department was going to be the new Attorney General would be coming into Baltimore, that we were all going to sit down and work together to try to see if we can't bring calm to the community and find answers in the case of Freddie Gray, but that was a separate situation, that he felt we absolutely needed to get control of our streets, and he endorsed the action that we're taking tonight.
Can you say when the Attorney General and possibly even the President might be coming up this week?
I don't know when. He didn't say when. All right. Any other last questions?
I know in the last time that Governor Maryland had to declare a state of emergency for civil
unrest. I don't believe I do know for sure, but it's probably 1968.
In light of that question, is this unprecedented? And if not, how does it compare to the rioting in the 60s?
Well, it's nowhere near as bad as that at this point. Well, we want to make sure that it doesn't get to that point. You know, it's certainly the worst thing I've seen since I've been governor, which is only 90 days. Any other questions? Thank you very much.
Just been hearing from the governor. As you heard, the National Guard is going to be sent into Baltimore. The head of the National Guard speaking, saying this is obviously not martial law, that they are there in support of the police department, but that they will be on the streets on patrol. That's different than when the National Guard was called into Ferguson. They were held back in areas really out of line of sight of many of what in Ferguson were protesters. Just after 9 p.m., a little bit, almost 10 after 9 in Baltimore. As you can see, sundown has not brought an end to the looting and rioting in parts of the city. What you're looking at there now, where you're told, is a massive fire in a multi-story, newly constructed building in East Baltimore. There are some reports that it's a new senior center that had been built. We are still trying to find out exactly which building the fire is in, but we're told it's at the corner of Chester and Gay Street, a multi-story building on fire. Miguel Marquez is heading there right now. I do want to go, while we continue to watch that, I want to check in with Joe Johns. Joe, where are you in relation to that fire? I'm not even sure if you can see that fire from where you are, if you know where it is.
No. I do not know where it is. I know of it. We've gotten some texts about it, and I believe I can hear some fire engines far in the distance, but I'm not sure exactly where it is from us.
Okay,
Anderson.
So we're looking now.
We're on West North Street.
And the important thing about that is that just gives our viewers a sense that these are incidents happening not all just
right.
In the same geographic location. These are incidents happening
precisely.
In different parts now of Baltimore. Joe, before we went to the governor, we saw a man named, I believe it was Robert Valentine, who stood between police,
yes,
and basically was trying to get young people who were taunting the police to go home. One of the things he said is about those young people, he said, they do not respect this young man's death, talking about Freddie Gray. It seems as if those young people have moved off. What's the scene now?
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, this man single-handedly stood down a group of kids who were coming over to taunt the police some more, and they got tired of it and, you know, yelled a few expletives, if you will, and walked on off. So the street here where we are is relatively quiet and peaceful now. They've rolled up the fire hoses. I think it's important to say the police stay here. It's not clear how long they're going to stay here, but their whole objective was to hold the crowd away while the fire department in the distance could continue and finish its work. And it looks like the department has just about done that. But, I mean, this is all sort of a symbol of how much Baltimore is going to have to do. This city has been trying to claw its way back. There are many neighborhoods on the west side that are just bombed out, like the one we're in. And the city has been working so hard to try to get its image back. And this is not good for that, obviously, Anderson. It's too bad. And the police department has a tremendous, tremendous trust problem. That's not to forgive the criminality and the looting that's been going on. But when the dust settles, this police department has a real trust problem with the community, and they're going to have to deal with that because they haven't dealt with it quite yet.
And Joe,
that's something to talk about after things quiet down, Anderson.
Yeah, and they are certainly not quieting down. That had been the hope, perhaps, that some of this would people just get tired of this. I'm joined by Mark Puente of the Baltimore Sun. Mark, can you tell me where you are right now?
Yeah, I'm at the corner of North Chester and Landvale, East Baltimore, across from the Southern Baptist Church. The church was building a new senior center, and right now that new senior center is all in total flames. Firefighters are standing back with their ladder trucks, and I need to get close to it.
And Mark, we're seeing those images that you are speaking about. So this was a new, brand new senior center that had been built by a church?
Yeah, the Southern Baptist Church, Pastor Dr. Dante L. Hickman Sr., the parishioners and worshipers that showed up. Lots of raw emotion. They're crying. They want to know who would do this to their church. They burnt the church bus. It appears that new construction is a total loss. The entire block is burned.
Mark, do you have a sense of just, you know, for our viewers who are watching this around the country and around the world, it's hard to get a sense of how many spots there are where police have been deployed, where there has been trouble. Do you have a sense of it, about how many active situations are going on right now?
Well, a colleague and I raced over here from downtown, and we passed many police on many corners throughout. I haven't seen a TV or reports from my colleagues at the Sun, but it appears all over the city. We passed a couple busloads of officers in riot gear being escorted in a motorcade, so they were going somewhere. But clearly, this is falling down.
And in terms of the response right now at that massive fire, we see a number of fire vehicles. We do see water being poured on it, but it looks like it is still out of control.
It is still out of control. They're not even going nowhere near it. They're just standing back from their ladders reaching the sky, pointing it that way. They're not getting close to it, but as you can see from your shot, holding tall.
And are there...
Pastor is on his way here, and people are upset.
Are there still young people in that area, or people in that area who... have been, I mean, is this an area that has seen looting earlier in the day? Are there still people on the streets there, or is it now pretty much just police, firefighters, and as you said, parishioners?
No, the crowd's growing, but it's mostly adults with their cell phones. A lot of people obviously go to this church because they're all out here crying and stuff. Not many kids. If there's kids, there was a kid.
Mark, the mayor made a big point of saying that at 9 p.m. there is already a curfew in place because it's a school night for people under the age of 13. For over the age of 14, the curfew is 10 p.m. Do you believe that that's going to have any impact? I mean, has it already had any impact?
Like I said, Anderson, on the way over here, there were still people on the street. I can't speak when they're going to go home or when they're get off the streets, but there's still the crowd's still growing here. There's 2 miles we drove to get here. There's people everywhere.
Well, Mark Puente, I appreciate you taking the time to talk to us. Mark from the Baltimore Sun. the paper of record in the city of Baltimore. While we continue to watch these images from the corner of Chester and Gay Street, this, according to Mark Puente, a new senior center that had been built by the Baptist Church in that neighborhood. It was a multi-story, newly constructed building in East Baltimore, a massive blaze. And as Mark said, there are a lot of parishioners. The pastor is on his way. A lot of parishioners there who have been crying, saying, why would anybody do this to our church? And we have heard those questions being asked in a lot of different places in Baltimore tonight. People near the CVS that was looted and burned, saying this was a new building, this was a sign of improvement for the community. We saw that also the bodega-type store in the corner being looted, as well as a check cashing store, a number of businesses being put up in flames or simply being broken into and robbed. I want to bring in, while we continue to watch these images and continue to check in with our correspondents, I also want to bring in our legal analysts, Sonny Hostin and Jeffrey Toobin, also former NYPD detective Harry Houck. Harry, just from a policing standpoint, again, as we continue to see this massive fire now burning still out of control right in the city of Baltimore, we now know the National Guard are going to be coming in. They are not on the streets at this point. Mm-hmm. It seems like the state police are going to be running this operation, more so, we just heard from the governor, than the city of Baltimore, than the mayor. The governor clearly kind of, I'm not sure how to categorize his feelings toward the mayor of Baltimore, but saying that he was glad that she finally did call him for help and to declare a state of emergency, which has been triggered. He said it took him 30 seconds after she finally requested it for him to bring it in. He clearly softening it, but being critical of the response by the mayor. In terms of the policing response, what have you been watching for the last several hours?
Well, I'll tell you, I haven't really been seeing much. I've been watching this all day today, and you know, this afternoon was the time to nip this in the bud before it got dark. It appears like the police department's response to this has been pretty pathetic all day, and I'm not blaming the police department. You know, the mayor's been very acting pathetic towards us and apathetic towards us, I'm sorry, all right, and actually holding the police back. When you got police officers in a riot situation like this who keeps on going forward, getting things thrown at them, going forward, then coming back and forth with the rioters, not sending out arrest teams, they're sending out a message to these youths out there saying, listen, hey, we can get away with this today. No problem.
That was a strategy which in Ferguson, you know, day two or three began to evolve. After the initial criticism, the police reaction, it did seem like they kind of learned from being on the ground in that situation, and while they would hold the line, they would send out a team, arrest an individual or two individuals, and then come back to the line, trying to isolate the people who were actually breaking the law.
Yeah, but you didn't see too much of this. I think we've had 20 or some arrests today, was the last count.
And so you're saying you didn't see that enough?
No, I didn't see enough of that at all. I've seen we got 15 police officers that are hurt here. Okay, there should be probably 60, 70, 80 arrests by now.
Do you believe they have enough resources on the ground, or is it a question of just how they've been deployed?
It doesn't look like that at all, because, you know, we're seeing what's going on in Baltimore right now just by the cameras that we have there. All right, what's going on in the rest of this area? Nobody saw anything going on near the senior center here. All right, and all of a sudden now we're going to that section there. So I think that the police officers don't have the resources that require to be able to handle this situation, and then should have had at least 1,000 police officers come from the surrounding towns in yesterday as a result of this. You know, last week when we were talking about this, Anderson, I predicted something like this was going to happen.
You were saying, where's the riot gear? Where's the equipment?
Exactly.
Sonny Hostin, you worked in the city of Baltimore. We should also point out you are a friend of the mayor's. What do you make of what you have seen and what you're seeing right now?
You know, I'm saddened by what I'm seeing. Clearly, I think everyone is saddened. But I think that to criticize the mayor, I think to criticize the police chief, I don't think that there is a place for that right now. I mean, everyone can sort of, you know, after the fact quarterback. But the bottom line is these are very fluid situations. Harry knows that. Just this weekend, no one was talking about Baltimore. Everyone was talking, you know, covering other news stories, because this wasn't what was going on in Baltimore at that time.
Well, there was violence in Baltimore on Saturday.
I think we can all agree, not of this magnitude,
sure.
Clearly. So it's a fluid situation, and people are responding to that fluidity. I think that certainly, you know, these are criminal actions. I think that's clear. No one is saying that looting is appropriate or rioting is appropriate. But the bottom line is, I think Martin Luther King said it well, that rioting is the language of the unheard. And let's remember that this is stemming from, yes, what started out as peaceful protest, but this is stemming from the death of a 25-year-old man. People in Baltimore,
you think the
clearly,
thugs that are doing this,
I don't think
really
name-calling at this point is helpful, Harry.